I'm getting a little bit of reverb back here. Come on. Genesis chapter 37. Genesis chapter 37. On number one, bring that slider down a little bit. Come on, you guys can hear me right there? That's good right there. Come on. All right, I'm going to yell a little bit, all right? You guys there? Same man. Come on. So in Genesis chapter 37, we come across a character, Joseph, right? Now, Joseph just wasn't any other kind of cat. Joseph had a gift. Joseph had this gift that was given by God. Joseph was a dreamer. Come on, how many of you guys ever had dreams?
Yeah.
Come on. Yeah. How many of you guys ever had dreams? Joseph was a dreamer, right? And in chapter 37, we meet this character, Joseph, right? And we meet him and his brothers. And Joseph has this dream when he's out pasturing the flock one day, right? He says, he comes back and he tells his brother, he says, I saw 12 sheaves of wheat, and mine was in the middle, and your 12 sheaves of wheat bowed down to mine. And his brothers looked at him and they laughed, and they're like, what is that supposed to mean? That we're going to be your slaves? And then he had another dream. He's like, I saw 12 stars, and I saw the sun and the moon, and they bowed down to me. And his dad goes, what is that supposed to mean? Are we supposed to be your servants? Come on, how many of you guys ever had a dream and somebody spoke against that dream? Come on, how many times has God given you a word, and somebody's like, what are you talking about? It's not that easy. Come on. I remember the first time I said I was going to plant a church over the pulpit. Woo! The backlash I got. That just sounds all interesting and sexy right now, Zach. That's the only reason why you want to do it, because that's what all the young hip pastors are doing. No, that's not why I want to do it. I want to do it because I know God has called me to do it.
Yes, amen.
Come on.
Preach it.
Come on. And I know what it's like to have your dreams spoken against. What is that supposed to mean? That we're supposed to be your slaves, Joseph? Come on. And so one day Joseph's with his father, and his father says, he says, Joseph, why don't you go check up on your brothers, because they're out there in the middle of the field somewhere. And he goes, all right, I'll go see what they want, Dad, you know. But Joseph has a reputation of being a tattletale. He's the youngest brother. You know, I can understand. I have a younger brother. He was a bit of a tattletale. You know, he rat me out all the time. No, I'm just kidding, Luke. But Joseph was a tattletale, right? And so he rats out his little brothers, right? And he rats out his older brothers all the time. And so when they see, it says that they saw Joseph from a long way off. Come on, how many know that the enemy is trying to stop you before you even begin? Come on, how many know that the enemy is trying to snuff you out before you even begin your ministry? That's why he's got you tangled up with pornography, drugs, and alcohol. That's why he's got you tangled up with social media and the here and the now. Because he's trying to snuff you out before you can get a grasp of what your purpose or what the dream is that God spoke into you. Come on.
Preach it.
And so here's Joseph, and his brothers see him from a long way off, and they decide to conspire against him, and they're like, we should totally kill this dude. I hate this guy, let's kill him. And so his second to the youngest brother, Reuben, he's like, no, we shouldn't kill this guy. We shouldn't kill this guy. After all, he's our brother. We'll just throw him in a pit. We'll just leave him to die in a pit, and if he starves there, that's fine. And so they see Joseph coming, they snatch him up. Come on, somebody say snatch.
Snatch.
And they snatch him up, right? And they throw him into the pit, right? And then here comes these Midianite traders, and they find Joseph, they buy him. And then his brothers, they're on their way back to their father's Jacob. They're on their way back, and they're like, I got an idea. Let's take his coat. Joseph had a coat of many colors. Joseph was Jacob's most prized possession. He was the youngest. It said that he was a child of his old age, and he loved him greatly. So he gave him a coat of many colors. And people came familiar. They associated Joseph with this coat of many colors, right? And so when his brothers, when they decide to sell him into slavery, they take his coat, and then they cut this goat's neck, and they drip the blood all over the goat, right? And they take the coat back to their dad, and they say, can you identify this? And he says, that's my son's jacket. That's my son's coat. That's Joseph's coat. How many know that the enemy is after your identity?
Yeah.
Come on. If the enemy can get you to think that your dream is nothing less than just a mockery to make fun of, then he's already got you in the bag. Yeah. If the enemy can see you from long enough and say, TJ, I see you, and I'm going to get you addicted to dope. I'm going to get you out there selling drugs. I'm going to get you out there watching pornography. I'm going to get you out there lying about everybody. Woo! If he can see you from a long way off and stop you from actually walking into the destiny that God has called you to, he's got it in. Come on. I was listening to a song this morning by this band called For Today, and they were saying, they said, I was listening to this band, and they were saying that their name would be feared at the gates of hell. Come on, how many want that kind of history, man? I want my name to be feared at the gates of hell. I want to leave such an impact for the glory of God and for God's kingdom that the enemy and his cohorts and the demons actually tremble when they hear that Zach Hernandez has showed up to preach at a youth group. Come on.
Yeah. Come on.
And so the enemy can trip you up and actually get you to take your eyes off your dream, the destiny that God actually called you to, which some people who are supposedly anointed laugh at you. If the enemy can get you to get off that and actually take your identity away from you because TJ, you're a preacher, because TJ, you're a rapper. Come on. If the enemy can shake TJ up and get him off that, come on. And so now Joseph is sold into slavery, and he becomes a slave to Potiphar. If you don't know who Potiphar is, right? Potiphar is the second in command of Egypt's things, right? And Potiphar, he sees Joseph, right? And Joseph's in slavery. But the Bible says that when Joseph was in the house of Potiphar, everything he did, God's hand was upon him.
Yeah.
Come on, you can't outrun your calling. It don't matter what you're doing, God's hand is still upon you, amen? Come on. Woo! Because it didn't matter if Joseph was just washing the dishes, God's hand was upon him. It didn't matter if he was looking at the flock, God's hand was upon him. And everything that he touched prospered. How many know that when I was out in the world and I was trying to run from God, God still had me preaching in the back of a party and I didn't know why? Like, I was the only guy that people would ask who Jesus was because they knew that I was a church kid. You cannot outrun your calling. That destiny that God put in your life will follow you wherever you go. God's anointing is on you. And it's on you. And so Joseph's in Potiphar's house, and he's blessed, and everything that he touches, God's hand is upon. And so Potiphar puts him second in command over everything in his house, right? And one day, Joseph's there. He's there, and Potiphar's wife comes in, and she sees Joseph, and she notices that she's handsome, that his stature is handsome, that he is handsome, kind of, you know, similar to me. No, I'm just kidding. I'm playing with y'all. But I had to put that one in there, you know. I had to take a shot at it. But Potiphar's wife sees Joseph, right? And she tells him, she says, "Lay with me." And Joseph's like, "No, I can't. Our master, Potiphar has put me in charge of everything. If I would do this, if I would betray him now, like, could you imagine put you in charge of everything and you betray them because they honored you because they saw the work that you were doing. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And so Joseph tells Potiphar's wife, it says that when Potiphar's wife tried to, she tried to lay a hold of him, right? And she grabbed him and she snatched his coat. She took his coat from him. Say, snatch his coat. Took his coat from him. But it said that he ran from her. I hope that in the day of temptation that we would run, amen? Come on. That we would run from temptation. But remember Joseph and his brothers. Remember how they took his coat of many colors and they said, "Identify this coat."
Yes. Yeah.
How many know that the enemy still plays the same exact game? He don't change the game up. He's still after your identity. If he can take your coat, whether you're a child or whether you're in the house of Potiphar, if he can take your coat and shake you up from actually understanding and walking in the destiny that God has called you to, he hasn't made. But I'm telling you, it doesn't matter the situation that you're in. God's hand is upon you. You can't do nothing. You cannot outrun God.
Amen.
I mean, look at Jonah and the whale. The story, Jonah. Here's Jonah. He's called to go forth to Nineveh. He jumps in this boat. He's like, "I'm leaving. I'm going down. I'm going somewhere else." So he says that he goes down to over here. Every word that is spoken about Jonah says that he's trying to run away. He's trying to go down away. And literally, that's what happens. Is that it wasn't until he was in the belly of the whale, right,
Amen.
That he came to his senses. He couldn't outrun God's calling on his life.
Yes.
He was called to go to Nineveh. And I'm telling you the same thing today. It don't matter what the dream is and what people say about the dream. When God's called you to do something, you have no power in hell can stop you from fulfilling what God has called you to do. Amen? Come on.
Yes.
Exactly. Yes. It doesn't matter. What God has called you to do, you will accomplish it. And so Joseph... He he doesn't just get sold into slavery, but he actually gets thrown into prison. Thrown into prison. Like, if that was the bottom for him, if that was rock bottom, this is really rock bottom for him, right? Come on. Like, that was bottom. Someone say bottom.
Bottom.
That was bottom. How many ever felt like you hit rock bottom?
Amen.
You all young, you don't know what rock bottom is until you're dead. No, I'm just kidding. But.
I know what it is.
Yeah, amen, exactly. And so Joseph's in prison, right? And so he's in prison, and he it says that God's hand was still upon him. It don't matter the situation. It don't matter your position.
Yeah.
If God's hand is on you, it is on you. Whether you're in prison, or whether you're a slave, or whether you're just a boy. Come on. If God's hand is upon you, amen. And so here's Joseph. He's in prison. And he's in prison, and finally there's this cupbearer and this baker, and for something, they do something funky with Pharaoh's stuff. And Pharaoh, he tells them, go to prison. He sends them in prison with Joseph. And so they're all in prison together. And it said that God's hand was upon Joseph, and he actually became the master of the prison. Like the guy that was in charge of the prison master or whoever he was, put Joseph in charge. And it said that he didn't have to worry about anything except for what he ate. Come on.
Amen.
Woo! That's Woo! What you know. Yeah, that's Amen. What, oh, come on. And so here's Joseph. He's in prison. I keep saying that. He's in prison, and there's these two. There's a cupbearer and there's a bread maker, and they have these dreams, and they're shaken up one night, and they don't understand what's going on. And so Joseph's like, well, let me hear it. Let me hear these dreams. And so Joseph, he revelates on them. He interprets a dream. I'm just giving you guys better read it for yourself. 37 to 50. 37 to 50. It's a big chunk. I know you guys got homework, but you'll figure it out. And so he revelates on them. He interprets a dream to them, right? And so they both come out of prison finally. And just as he interprets exactly what happens, the cup maker or the cupbearer actually, he lives, and the bread maker dies. But Joseph told the cupbearer, he said, don't forget me when you get out of this place. Don't forget me. Well, what does the cupmaker bear do? He forgets.
Yeah.
He forgets Joseph. And so Joseph's all by his lonesome in this prison. And finally, one day, Pharaoh has a dream. And it was disturbing. He woke up in a cold sweat, I imagine that. And he's like, man, I don't know what this is. And he goes to all the sorcerers and all the mystics of the land trying to interpret this dream, and they cannot interpret it for him. And finally, the cupbearer overhears what happens, and he's like, hey, I know a guy. How many know a guy?
Amen.
Come on. I know a guy. His name's Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
And he says, I know a guy. He's like, I know a guy. And so Pharaoh's like, well, you better bring him forward because I don't know what's going on with this dream. And so Joseph comes out of prison, and he interprets Pharaoh's dream. How many know that the same exact dream that God spoke into you is the same exact dream that you might be persecuted for, you might be challenged for, but it's the same exact dream that God's going to use to raise you up? Oh, come on now. Come on. The same exact one that God gave you. Come on. If God said that you were going to be a pastor, you're going to be a pastor, and no matter what nobody's going to say. Come on. If God is for you, who can be against you? You guys have a mission field out there, man. You guys got a high school. You guys got two high schools. Come on, and I'm there with you. I'm here to bear arms with you. I ain't going to let you go on alone. That's why I'm here preaching this with my lungs out, because I know you guys need it. Come on. And so the same exact dream, the same word that God spoke into you, that you know God spoke to you, is the same exact word that you get criticized for. The same exact word that you get persecuted for. The same exact word that draws you out of a prison and sets you before men that God uses. The Bible says that God resists the proud but raises the humble. Come on, amen? Come on, you ain't got to fight for it. You ain't got to fight for it. Come on. If God is for us, who can be against us, guys? And so Joseph, it says that he interpreted this dream, right? And now he's out of prison. Now he's before Pharaoh. And the same dream, like I said, gets him out of prison. And Pharaoh, he comes along and he says, bring this man the fine. He tried to fight Joseph for the coat. The same exact idea. The enemy tried to fight Joseph for when he was in Potiphar's house. It's the same exact identity that now Joseph is finally fulfilling that God has called him to be. Pharaoh says, he said, bring the finest linens and give it to this man. Come on. How many know that the riches of the wicked will be stored up for the righteous? Amen?
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
Amen. Come on. How many know that we're blessed in the city and in the field?
Yes.
It doesn't matter the position. Come on. Yes. I'm telling you guys.
Yes.
Come on. Like you're going into a facility that wants nothing to do with God.
Amen.
you're going into a facility that's just a breeding ground for just, I don't even want to go there. But this is a thing that that the Spirit of God that raised Christ from the dead, that lives inside of you, is now going to have the HS, is now going to Pacheco High School. Come on, you are the light in the dark places. You are the salt of the earth. Come on. There's no reason. Come on, guys. I'm telling you, that the same exact Spirit, come on, that raised Christ from the dead, it quickens our mortal bodies so that we are now overcomers. We're no longer bound to sin and death. You see, look at Joseph. Joseph was, it says that he was sold into slavery. How many know that we're no longer slaves to sin? Come on. It said that he was a slave. It said that he was put in prison. How many know that we're no longer bound to sin and death? Come on, why? Because on the third day, our Jesus Christ, the same God who's in heaven, he rose on the third day. Come on, guys. Woo! Come on.
Amen.
If we it's the identity that the enemy's after. If he can shake your identity, we sing the song "I Am a Child of God" for a reason. So we can instill that into our. The Bible says that faith only comes by hearing of the word of God. The Bible also says that as a man thinketh, so is he.
Amen.
That's why we sing that song, "I Am a Child of God," so that when the enemy comes to tell you lies, you can be like, you know what, devil? I'm gonna flick you out of here, man. You're the same slithery snake that you were 100,000 years ago. And guess what? I'm a child of the living God. And you can't touch me. She said, that's sneakily snake.
That's sneakily snake.
Come on. And you remember Joseph's brothers, the same ones that sold him into slavery? The same ones that threw him in the pit?
Yeah.
Well, they come crawling back to Egypt one day because there's famine in the land. They come crawling back to Egypt because there's famine in the land. Woo! Yeah. I know, come on. And here's Egypt. Here's Joseph. He's second in command of all of Egypt, and he's actually sitting on the throne. He has his own pad and everything in Egypt. And they come and they're like, well, we came to buy grain because there's great famine in the land. And the thing that really spoke to me was that at the end of Joseph's life, he not only does he reconcile with his brothers, not only he actually comes back to his father. His father thought he was dead. And he reconciles with his father, and he's alive, and it's this great, harmonious time, right? But Joseph says something that was really important, and he says, what you meant for evil, God made it for good.
Amen.
Come on, the trials and the tribulations that we face, the situations, the positions, the friendships, the relationships, that we're in, that sometimes we think are like, God, this isn't working, right? God, I don't know what this is. Why do I keep failing? Why do I keep stumbling? I don't know what this is, God. But the things that the enemy meant for evil, God meant for good. Come on.
Yeah.
It don't matter. Yeah. Come on.
Yeah.
If you feel like you fell short yesterday, how many know that God's mercies and grace are new every morning?
Amen.
Come on. Yeah. If you feel like, I'm not called, I'm not, God hasn't put purpose in my life. God hasn't called me to do some fantastic thing. Come on, God put breath in your lungs.
Amen.
Yeah.
God put you here for a reason. There is a specific designed reason for you to be here. Don't let nobody shake that from you. We're going to close in prayer right now, guys. If you guys want, you guys to stand up. We're going to just speak some words of faith over you right now. That God would increase. God would increase. Thank you, Father. You're worthy, Father God, of all praise and all glory, God. You're worthy, Father God. There's none like you, Father. We worship you, God, because you are so glorious, God. God, while we were faithless, you were still faithful, God. Lord, when we were down and out, Father, you raised us up, Father. God, when we thought there was no way, you made a way, God. God, where sin and death had a hold of us, God, you set us free from it, God. God, we thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, and what he accomplished on that cross, and what he did when he walked into that grave, and when he rose again on the third day, God, we thank you, God. God, I pray, Lord, right now, Father, I pray, Lord, for a fire, Father, for a reality, Father God, of the resurrection power, God. I pray, Lord, that every youth in this building that is under the sound of my voice, God, would catch a revelation of our risen King, Jesus Christ. God, I pray, Lord, right now, Father, that every child, every youth that is in this building, God, that that divine purpose would begin to blossom in their life, Father God. We bind and we rebuke any plan of the enemy and all his demons in Jesus' mighty name. The name of Jesus is stronger, and at the very name of Jesus, demons have to flee. And right now, we say in Jesus' mighty name, God, divine purpose, divine calling, Father. Lord, I know you're raising up a generation, Father God, of God-fearing men, of God-fearing women, Father, in a generation that looks faithless, God. God, I pray, Lord, right now, Father, for every youth in this building, Lord. Lord, that you would just be, that their reality would be shaken, Father. Lord, we pray, Lord, for an open heaven over their lives, Father, that they would begin to walk according to your Spirit, Father. Your Spirit would lead and guide them, Father God. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you protect them from temptation and the very sight of it, that they would run, Father. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you protect them, Father God. I pray, Lord, that you continue to raise them up and give them wisdom and knowledge, Father God, according to the gifts that you poured out into them, Father. God, I pray, Lord, right now, Father God, for every individual, Lord. Those of us that are faithless, God, that you would begin to bring faith and breathe faith into us, God. Those of us that are hopeless, God, you would begin to make us hopeful, Father God. Those of us who aren't thankful, God, you would make us thankful, Father, for what your Son did, God. I pray, Lord, that you would shake the foundations of our inner core, Father God, that everything that is not built upon our identity in Jesus Christ and what he accomplished on that cross would be shaken from us, God. That you would call us out into the water, into the deeper parts, Father God. Lord, you spoke to these kids today, Lord. You told them to take a city, God. You told them to take a school, God. I pray that you continue to raise them up, Father. God, you're worthy of all praise and all glory, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.